Thank you for the kind invitation extended to me by His Eminence Bishop Kyrillos Avidos, the President of the Society for the Law of Eastern Churches, to speak at the 23rd International Congress of the Society. In my address today, I shall talk about primacy and synodality in the Syriac Orthodox tradition in the context of moral discernment and ethical decisions that are to be made. First, I shall give a brief account of the Syriac Church to situate it in the historical context. Second, I will say a few words about canon law in the Syriac tradition. Next, I shall reflect about primacy and synodality in the Syriac Orthodox tradition regarding the moral discernment and ethical decisions that are to be made. Finally, I will offer some concluding remarks on the subject under consideration. The Syriac Orthodox Church of Antioch belongs to the Oriental Orthodox family of churches. It forms a distinct Oriental Christian tradition. It exists alongside Greek and Latin tradition, which provide the basis for modern Western Christian tradition. Its importance and significance within Christian traditions stems from the fact it is rooted in the biblical Semitic world out of which the Bible and Christianity sprang. Earliest Syriac tradition after the 4th century is Semitic in character and is free from the later influences of Greek culture and thought patterns. This is very much to be seen in the writings of Ephrem the Syrian in the 7th and the 8th centuries. Nor was the influence one way only, Greek and on Syriac. Syriac tradition has also had its own influence on Greek and Latin traditions. In the 5th century, more Ephrem enjoyed immense prestige as poet and writer, and many of his works were translated into Greek and then into Latin. Thus, he came to be a well-known figure in the medieval West. It is also important to bear in mind that the Syriac Church faced many persecutions and horrific massacres throughout its history, especially the genocide of 1915, during the First World War, in which the Syriac, Armenian and Pontiac Greek Christian population of Anatolia were massacred at the hands of Turks and Kurds in the last years of the Ottoman Empire. In the Syriac oral tradition, 1915 is referred to as Seifo, that's to say the year of the sword, or Firmano, that's to say the year of the Firman, an official decree by the Ottoman Sultan to kill the Christian population living within its extensive territory. These and many other horrific events led to the dwindling as well as dispersion of many members of the Syrian community in the various countries of the Middle East and subsequently through the Western world, where today we find a sizable diaspora community in Americas, Europe, Australia, and New Zealand. Furthermore, the terrible events also had a major impact on social conditions and consequently on canon law development in the Syriac Orthodox tradition. In the Syriac Orthodox tradition, the Syriac polymath, Catholicos Parabreus, in the 13th century, wrote normal canon called Hudoit in Syriac as a collection of canon law and a digest of past Syrian Orthodox Church canons. However, he augmented this collection with rules and canons he selected from other schools of thought. He made a distinction between the two groups by labeling the second as Hudoi or guides. After Barabreus, there was a period of stagnation in canon law due to the troubled history of the Syriac Church in the Levant. It wasn't until the very late 19th and the early 20th century that canon law received its share of revival as part of the revival of the Syriac Church throughout the 20th century. One of the main personalities of this revival was Peter Jan from Barcelona, who had brought into focus the rich cultural heritage of the Syriac Orthodox Church and the deep spiritual, historical, and ecumenical foundation of its canon law. It is against this background that I would like to consider the primacy and synodality in the Syriac tradition. In doing so, I shall consider three related areas as parameters for an authoritative moral discernment in the Syriac tradition, namely sources of authority, structures of authority, and finally, the dynamics of authority. Sources of authority. In the Syriac tradition, scripture is used as a foundation and the primary source of inspiration in relation to other sources for moral discernment. In addition to scripture and church tradition, the other key sources considered for moral discernment and are employed in such a process include a prayer, conscience, reason, oikonomia in Syriac and Dobronutho, the human culture, philosophy, and related sciences. The importance of the church in making a moral discernment is that the tradition complements the scripture and provides a parameter slash direction in making a moral discernment. Here the tradition is to be understood as all that has been received and handed over from the past to the world of the Holy Spirit. The Syriac Church uses a hermeneutical method which is deeply contemplative, based on a close reading of the scripture, with an eye to the telemistic symbol or type in terms of which God chose to make revelations to the Church. The biblical text, beyond its apparent simplicity, is open to many meanings, which create a complexity of which Ephrem, the 4th century Syriac father and doctor of the Universal Church, is a creative interpreter. In his commentary on the Diatessaron, that's to say the harmony of the four Gospels, Ephrem says, "If the face of the words of Scripture were only one, then the first interpreter would be able to explain it, and the rest of the scholars would have no toil in seeking nor joy of discovery. Instead, each of our Lord's words has its forms, and every form has many members, and each of the members has its own character and form. Everyone thus understands as he is able and interprets according to what has been given to him or her." Brother Savino Chiara from the community of Bosse, in his article titled "St. Ephrem the Syrian as a Reader of Holy Scripture, a Witness of Plurality in Biblical Hermeneutics," explains the passage saying, "This passage seems to indicate two reasons why the text remains inexhaustible in its meanings. A first reason is given by the words themselves, which are complex, hence inexhaustible. The other is due to the reader's objective situation, who understands according to his or her own capacity. The concept of the impossibility of producing the meanings, because of the double complexity of the text and of the reader's situation, is again clearly repeated in another passage of the commentary on the Diatessaron, where Ephrem, addressing God, explains, 'Who is able to reach the limit of even one of your expressions? In fact, what we give is much more than what we take, like the thirsty at the spring. Your world has many faces, just as there are many faces of those who study. Thus, the biblical word and those who study and meditate upon it possess many faces. Consequently, this gives rise to the variety of interpretations as two criteria of the hermeneutic fruitfulness of the biblical text, one intrinsic to the text and the other extrinsic. Ephrem explains this double richness, intrinsic and extrinsic, by using two images, namely that of a spring and that of a mirror. Regarding the intrinsic fruitfulness of the text, Ephrem employs the image of a spring. He explains, 'God has impressed many beauties on his world, so that every one of those who study may study what he loves, He has hidden in his vault all kinds of treasures, so that each one of us may be enriched by what he meditates on. His vault is the tree of life. That's in reference to Genesis chapter 2, which from everywhere offers you blessed fruit. It is like the rock that was open in the desert, in comparison with Exodus chapter 17, verse 6, becoming for everyone around it a spiritual drink. It has been said, they ate a spiritual food and drank a spiritual drink, from the letter of St. Paul to the Corinthians chapter 1, verse 4. Here the Apostle Paul makes the reference to the Eucharist that has never been extensive to the scripture, saying, whoever then comes to Scripture should not believe that the single richness that he has found is the only one there is. Rather, he should hold that it is he who has been capable of finding that one among the many that Scripture contains. Nor should he believe that, having been enriched by Scripture, he has impoverished. Rather, not being able to understand it, he should confess its greatness. Ephrem goes further to elucidate the image of a spring intrinsic to the biblical text, saying, rejoice because you have been satiated, and do not be sad on account of what is greater than you. The thirsty man rejoices because he has drunk, but is not sad because he is incapable of exhausting the spring. May the spring overcome your thirst, and not your thirst overcome the spring. If, in fact, your thirst is extinguished without the spring being diminished, then every time you are thirsty, you can still drink. But if, while you say to yourself, the spring is dry, your victory over it will be your ruin. Give thanks for what you have drawn, and do not murmur for what you have left and is left over. What you have taken and carried away is your part. What has been left is still your inheritance. As to the second criterion, the fruitfulness extrinsic to the text, Ephrem employs the image of a mirror. This is very beautifully expressed in his letter to Publius. He addresses his correspondent, saying, you do well by not allowing the shining mirror of your Lord's holy gospel to fall from your hands. It reflects, in fact, the image of all those who look at it and reveals the similarity of all those who scrutinize themselves in it, while it preserves its nature and does not suffer any alteration, remaining removed from spots and free of dirt. Nevertheless, when colored objects are placed before it, it changes its aspect without changing itself. Before white objects, it becomes like them. Before black objects, it assumes their aspect. Before red objects, it becomes red like them. Before beautiful objects, it becomes beautiful like them. And before detestable objects, it becomes ugly like them. From what is said above, it becomes clear that the pages of Scripture do not only reflect the face of God, whose narrative and teaching it contains, but also the face of the person who reads it. Here, Ephrem explains the concept with the image of a face that is reflected in the page so as to provoke a reaction, a change, and at the same time to suggest a remedy, the work needed by each, and continues. It reflects upon itself every member of the body. Those who are detestable by taking up their defects, so that they may remedy them and remove the dirt from their faces. To those who are beautiful, it announces that they should pay attention to their beauty so that it may not be marred by dirt, and should moreover heighten their created nature with ornaments of their free choice. Although it's mute, it speaks. It shouts in its silence. While you think that it is a dead object, it announces. Although it is immobile, it dances. Although it is without a body, its womb is spacious, and in those hidden interior rooms, every member is represented. Scripture, then, is the pearl of many reflections, the inexhaustible spring, the mirror that reflects ever new images according to the person who is before it. The scripture is living an open world, which no one can seal or close. Neither the person who reads and contemplates it devotionally, nor the clergy who explain it to the faithful in the context of a liturgical celebration in the church. This is the hermeneutical method by which Ephrem the Syrian constructs his thought about God to take up the triad of an exegete, theologian, and a poet. According, in fact, to the Jesuit father Robert Murray, Ephrem is the only patristic father with a patristic age to rank beside Dante Alighieri, because he is the only poet theologian, and he employs poetry as a vehicle for his biblical commentary and about the mystery of God and faith. We thus see all the coherence, both of the formation of this thought and of its expression. This is a theology that leaves room for God's and man's complexity, as scripture itself demands through its double fruitfulness, intrinsic as divine and extrinsic, that is, structures of authority. The term hierarchical would probably best describe the structure of the Syriac Orthodox Church of Antioch. Within the structure, I quote His Holiness, the Patriarch is the supreme head of the Church and its Holy Synod, the general supervisor of all religious and administrative affairs. Furthermore, the Constitution of the Church states that the Holy Synod, headed by His Holiness, the Patriarch, is the supreme religious, spiritual, legislative, and administrative authority of the Syrian Orthodox Church of Antioch. In the Syrian Orthodox model, the regional church structure is typically composed of archdioceses and dioceses. Each archdiocese or diocese has its own council, which is representative of clergy and laity, and convened and presided over by the bishop. This council exercises prescribed legislative, administrative, and judicial functions. The council may also have its own committees and other bodies. The council is the deliberative body for administrative, cultural, social, economic, and patrimonial matters composed of representatives of clergy and laity elected by the parishes. The representation in the structure of the Syriac Orthodox Church for moral discernment is understood in the following way. Officially, the Holy Synod decides on behalf of others, but the Holy Synod also inclines an ear to the clergy and the laity alike through the parish board headed by the parish priest and the archdiocesan board, which falls under the auspices of the metropolitan or the diocesan bishop. This is because in the last century, in addition to the canon law, the church constitution specified the establishment of parish boards within each diocese, with membership consisting of laity under the presidency of the metropolitan or bishop of the diocese. Parish boards have been strong features of lay participation in the 20th century. And bylaws regulating the functions were enacted and modified over the years. The bylaws enacted by the synod held at Mormatai Monastery, which is located in modern-day Iran, in 1930 were subsequently updated to better serve community needs. The last version issued in the 20th century was the unified bylaws of the local parish councils adopted at all the archdioceses of the Syriac Orthodox Church of Antioch, which was decreed by the Holy Synod on March 31st, 2000. The bylaw embodied a century-old tradition functioning civil participation in non-theological church matters and communal activities working in close coordination with church leadership. This tradition in joint administration found relevance in the diaspora, where this is a common tradition. The relationship in terms of authority between local, national, regional, and worldwide structure from all the sermon in the Syriac Church is hierarchical. The Patriarch is the supreme head of the Church and her highest authority. He is the one who calls for a Holy Synod and invites the diocesan bishops, members of the Holy Synod, beforehand to send the relevant topics and items to be added to the agenda of the Holy Synod. It must be mentioned that although the Holy Synod is called by and convened under the auspices of the Patriarch and attended only by the diocesan bishop, the priests and the laity through the Archdiocesan Council are also involved in the process of the decision-making, and in some cases, they may even influence the decision of the Holy Synod. Furthermore, there is some room for special cases to be decided upon by the local bishop for the spiritual welfare of the faithful. As the father of the parable of the prodigal son wills the salvation of his children in a similar fashion, the diocesan bishop decides on certain matters and thereby providing the necessary means and ways for the salvation of the faithful. Finally, the dynamics of authority. To an extent, the local context affects the structures and processes of pastoral discernment. Because of the nature of the universality of the Church and the dispersion of the faithful throughout the world, the Syriac Church is doing more discernment in a worldwide context, with room and relevance for the local and national context. The Church is inevitably bound up with the society and culture within which it is situated. The differences between different dioceses in different parts of the world are therefore likely to be more pronounced in this area than in the sources and structures of authority. Some relatively common features might nonetheless be tentatively identified. What is distinct about the Syriac tradition structure and processes for moral discernment is her therapeutic approach rather than the judicial approach in dealing with the brokenness and infirmity of the human nature. This might be best understood in the context of the parable of the prodigal son in Luke chapter 15, where the emphasis is put on the healing the prodigal son through the unconditional love of the merciful father. This act of mercy and unconditional love does not only bring healing and restoration to the broken, wayward son, but also make him sit at the right hand of the father to nourish his soul and body from the banquet set before him, and thereby rejoices with the father and all the invited guests to the wedding. Now I'd like to set an example from Ephrem's creation of women's choir in the Syriac church to elucidate the story. Ephrem lived in the 4th century. He was a native of Nisibis, a border city situated between the Romans and the Persians. His time was difficult and reflects some common features of today, as we experience in the Middle East. When his home city, Nisibis, was ceded by the Persians, he became a refugee, together with the rest of the Christian community, left and went to eastwards to Edessa, where he spent 10 years of his life. In the time of Ephrem, there were many rival groups, many unorthodox groups. In order to protect the faithful of the church from these heretical unorthodox groups, Ephrem established a choir of women, and he composed especially Madroshe teaching songs for these women. When we read in St. Paul, in his letter to the Corinthians, chapter 14, verse 34, we come to the following text. Let your woman keep silence in the churches, for it is not permitted unto them to speak, but they are commanded to be under obedience, as also says the law. Here we have a command from a biblical text that women should keep silent in the church. But Ephraim, on the contrary, in fact, he forms choir of women in the church to sing in unison with their husbands and brethren. Later, Jacob of Sarug, another important and famous poet theologian in the Syriac tradition, in his panegyric hymn about Ephraim, he likens Ephraim to Moses. He says, "You have become second Moses for the Syriac community, as Moses led the Israelites through the Red Sea, and then his sister Miriam took the tambourines to offer praise to the Lord for the salvation accorded to them. In a similar fashion, you opened the mouth of the Syrian woman, which was shut." And Jacob says this is not innovation. It is really within the biblical tradition. And this is how he tries to explain this. Ephraim, seeing that there was a need for the church to survive and be protected, and for the woman to take an active role in the liturgy of the church and to sing praises, and through his teaching songs, through his madroshe, to learn the faith, and this way to have a fence, as it were, around the faithful to protect them from the heretical groups and thereby attain salvation. Here we see that Ephraim was a deacon at the service of the local bishop of Nisibis, James of Nisibis. And he was also a poet theologian. He plays a role in making some changes or bringing certain elements to the church which were not there for the salvation and well-being of the faithful. And here we see that how the Bible is employed in making these decisions and coming up with such things for the well-being and welfare of the church. And this is in fact very much observed throughout the church history, especially in the current times, where we have other challenges, and this is not only for our modern times, but also for the antiquity, although the examples and the challenges that we are facing are somehow different. And this is also within the Jewish tradition as well as in the Christian tradition. The Jews, for example, who were living in the diaspora, had forgotten their Hebrew language, and the Jews of Jerusalem had said that the Bible should only be in the Hebrew language and not in any other language. But the Jews of the diaspora wanted to read the Bible in the Greek language and pray in Greek. Therefore, they came up with a story, King Ptolemy inviting 70 people from Jerusalem to translate the Bible, the Torah from Hebrew into Greek. And he gave them rooms and they translated the Bible into Greek. And when they compared the translation, they came to find out that they were similar. And the conclusion was that the Bible can be inspired also in a different language. And therefore, the Septuagint was created, which has become also the great authoritative version of the Orthodox speaking, the Orthodox Christians today. So these and many other elements play an important role in making decisions and helping the faithful overcome the challenges that they are facing in their life and their times. And this can be elaborated further, and I'm aware that in fact what I have stated has to be improved and developed, and hopefully it will be done in the future, and I would very much welcome your comments about this. Thank you.
Nous remercions Monseigneur Polycarpus pour son exposé si intéressant pour nous, qui a parlé sur la primauté et synodalité.